Hello, everyone, and welcome to the first in a series of special COVID-19 webinars hosted by the International Society for the Prevention of Child Abuse and Neglect. Today, we have with us Barbara Fallon from the University of Toronto and Delphine Collin-Vezina from McGill University, who will present and lead a discussion on information from the new report, Child Welfare and Pandemics Literature Scan. This report, published by the University of Toronto under the leadership of Principal Investigator Marina Sistovaris, focuses on current knowledge of child welfare and pandemics, the impact on children in the Canadian child welfare system, potential policy solutions, and the measures taken to control the spread of disease. After Dr. Fallon's presentation, Dr. Collin-Vezina will lead the Q&A with questions from the audience. Right now, I have you on mute to avoid background noise. We welcome you to enter your questions and comments in the questions box throughout the presentations. The presenters will answer the questions at the end as time permits. A recording of this webinar and a PDF of the slides will be available afterward on the ISCAN website. One moment, please. Sorry, I'm having a bit of a technical issue. Okay. We wanted to say that we know that you and child protection professionals worldwide are working very hard to understand and manage the effects of COVID-19 on our systems of care. And ISPCAN sincerely thanks our presenters and all of you for taking the time to be with us today. My apologies, I'm trying to go back to another slide, but I'm getting a webinar full message on my screen that won't allow me to switch my slides. One moment. Okay, sorry for that. Okay. Dr. Barbara Fallon is a professor of social work at the University of Toronto and holds the Canada Research Chair in Child Welfare. She directs studies on the incidence of child abuse and neglect in Ontario and for First Nations communities in Canada. Her research focuses on alleviating the suffering of children and families served by the child welfare system and has influenced child welfare policy and practice, including the improvement of data collection on Indigenous children and families. Dr. Delphine Collin-Vezina is a licensed clinical psychologist, Tier 2 Canada Research Chair in Child Welfare, an associate professor in the McGill School of Social Work, and Social Pediatrics Chair in the Department of Pediatrics. She has led several significant grant projects on mental health, family violence, and service provision, and her research has contributed to improved child protection responses and trauma-related services for children and adolescents. Barbara and Delphine, we thank you again so much for being with us today and for your contributions to child protection. Now I will turn it over to Barbara. One moment, please.
So, okay. Yes, thank you, Heather. Thank you very much. Thank you to Heather and to ISPCAN folks for inviting us to talk about the literature scan. We're very aware of the number of people who have registered to participate, and I'm confident about two things. The first is the sentiment that Heather expressed, is that our community is brimming with very smart, dedicated people who care deeply about putting in place supports to address the impact of the pandemic on children and families served by child welfare systems. And Barbara, the second...
Barbara, if I could interrupt you for one second, could you switch your display setting to full screen?
From my end, Heather, it is,
okay.
But I try. Is that better?
Yes, thank you so much.
Okay, apology. I guess the second observation I would make is that the response to the webinar really reflects the need for our community to come together and to hear about innovative practices and responses that can be adapted to different contexts. When Heather approached me to do the webinar, I quickly enlisted my dear friend and colleague, Delphine Collin-Vetinier, who really has extensive clinical experience with child welfare populations, and who will help me respond to questions at the end of the presentation. I suspect that there will be a lot of discussion about the applicability of specific interventions, and her expertise will be invaluable. We suggested to Heather that the socio-ecological framework that's in the literature scan that framed the literature synthesis would potentially be a good framework for organizing both the questions that arise from the webinar and for categorizing and cataloging the promising interventions that are emerging as the result. And I'm sure that this webinar will result in hundreds more that will be identified by our larger community. Point out that I have been elected to present the literature scan, but the work was done by Dr. Sistoveras, who is a principal researcher of the Fraser Mustard Policy Bench, and really in response to a specific request from our ministry about any existing evidence that could help guide the response to the pandemic. And the Fraser Mustard University of Toronto Policy Bench is co-led by Dr. Stephen Miller of Sick Children Hospital and myself. And it was designed as a mechanism to respond to requests from government for evidence that would inform short, mid, and longer-term policy needs of government pertaining to child development. We wanted the policy bench to be transdisciplinary and intentional about providing synthesis of diverse literatures that reflected our desire to think about children more holistically and to consider their physical, mental education, and social needs. And the faculty for the policy bench really reflects that diversity. So we have our colleagues from the Hospital for Sick Children, Catherine Birkin, Abby Denver, and of course, Stephen. Joel Levine is professor of the Department of Biology. Marla Sekalowski is professor of the Department of Cell and Systems Biology. Jenny Jenkins from Applied Psychology and Human Development at the University of Toronto. Say Mishna is at the Faculty of Social Work at the University of Toronto. But the whole idea really works thanks to Dr. Sistoveras, who is able to quickly master vast literatures and really is able to provide clear frameworks in response to specific policy requests. Fraser Mustard was one of the great champions of children. He passed away in the year 2011, but his vision for children was really a galvanized international community that reflected his fundamental belief that it took diverse academic disciplines and practice communities to come together to focus on interventions in the early years of life. And that the efficacy in these interventions and a holistic approach to children really would result in unparalleled potential for improved quality of life. A reminder, just to situate the literature scan that we published, or not published, I guess posted online, was that it was conducted nearly 2 weeks ago, almost 3 weeks ago. So we are already very aware that there are many more resources and thinking around child welfare systems and pandemics that have become available and are being circulated through wide distribution lists. So those will not be reflected in the content. We really wanted to frame the literature review, I think particularly a couple of weeks ago, with some precise language around pandemics. The terminology was being used in the media inconsistently to mean different things. So we spent some time in the document framing the differences between epidemics and pandemics. the socio-ecological approach to the literature scan really helped us to think about how to organize practice, policy, and systems responses. We relied fairly heavily on a document that was published or posted by UNICEF and a Kelly and Hansel review around emerging COVID-19 concerns, a child welfare perspective from the United States. So those documents in this webinar will be particularly highlighted. And then we tried to synthesize the existing literature again a couple of weeks ago around policy implications and how we could use some thinking, some evidence to design appropriate child protection strategies to respond to the pandemic. And finally, we'll conclude the webinar with a few observations, and then I'm sure that the greater benefit is to bring together this community in a discussion about innovative practices. The literature review is available, I think, also through ISPACAN and through the Child Welfare Research Portal. We've done brief summaries of the literature scan that are available in French and in English, so people can download the document that I'm going to be summarizing. The methodology for the review, again, the intention was to quickly search the literature about any emerging themes, practices, policies that could help us to begin to think about child systems response. So it was done in 5 days. Thank you to Marina, who accomplished the impossible. The first thing we did was to generate a list of keywords and search terms, and we did those by looking at abstracts, government documents, subject heading and phrases, and then engaging in an iterative process where we added and deleted search terms, modified them until we settled on a search strategy and implemented it with the keywords pandemic, COVID-19, children policy, and mitigation. The data sources were peer-reviewed journals that are found in electronic databases and the internet-based grade literature. So the dynamics of a pandemic when compared to an epidemic, again, this was conducted two and a half weeks ago, feels like years ago sometimes, 2.5 weeks ago. And when compared to an epidemic, a pandemic often affects a wider geographical area, and now we know it is indeed worldwide, greater number of people than an epidemic. It is caused by a new virus or strain in which humans have no immunity or little immunity against it. The spread, the transmissibility is high. It spreads very quickly from person to person. The associated morbidity and mortality with the virus is also higher than in an epidemic. And as we all know, it creates social disruption, economic loss, and general hardship. Again, as of March 30th, and listening to the Canadian news this morning, the infected rate, I now know it's over a million people. As of today, but as of March 30th, it was under a million people. The mortality rate as of March 30 was 3.4%. There is variation, of course, within populations, among populations. And again, the COVID-19 is highly transmittable, and that the impact is felt in high rates of morbidity and mortality. There are flu-like symptoms, cough, fever, but the virus can also be asymptomatic, and that's probably responsible for some of the community spread that we're seeing. As I mentioned in my introductory remark, the literature review is framed with a socio-ecological model. We wanted to examine the potential impact on the individual and the associated risks for families, for communities, for society, and for sociocultural norms. For children, of course, there are heightened risks of abuse and neglect, of experiencing or witnessing violence, exploitation, psychological distress, and negative impact on development. for families, there's likely both family separation and family confinement. There is a reduction in social supports for families and children that already may suffer from a lack of social supports or isolation, caregiver distress, and heightened risk of violence and domestic abuse. For communities, the concern is around a breakdown of trust, competition over scarce resources, limited access to typical community supports and education because of school closures and a lack of access to outdoor play spaces for children or environments where they can play. Certainly for society, an erosion of social capital, a disruption or limited access to basic services and socio-cultural norms, threat is around stigmatization for and against certain groups. The UNICEF document presented a broad framework to think about child protection systems and the response to pandemics. So we found it particularly helpful. Neglect may be the result of the unprecedented economic hardships that families and children are experiencing, but it also, the pandemic is and can result in supervision issues presented with the closure of daycares, schools, and the expectation from caregivers' employment about work that needs to happen both outside and inside the home. It's very clear that the mental and psychosocial distress that COVID-19 pandemic presents impacts everyone in the population, but will have particularly deleterious impacts on populations with pre-existing mental health challenges. With the measures being undertaken to contain the spread of infection, social, physical isolation, and the resulting economic, social, and health impact will increase children's exposure to violence and the likelihood that they experience sexual, physical, and emotional abuse. And then again, 2 weeks ago, the article by Kelly and Hansel that discussed a child welfare perspective from the United States was particularly helpful as they documented very systematically the emerging concerns and helped to frame some of the more precise thinking that we've engaged in when we think about Ontario child welfare services. Certainly, there's a concern about the increase in maltreatment cases and also somewhat paradoxically a decrease in reports to child welfare services. For example, in Ontario, 33% of investigations are referral from schools, and agencies are reporting a decline in reports or concerns for maltreatment already. So how to make sure that the populations that are normally referred from a school are identified and served during the pandemic is certainly an issue that we're struggling with in the province of Ontario. Food insecurity and nutrition is already an issue for many of our families, and access is and likely to be an issue that needs a systematic response. Substance use in Ontario, 1 in 10 investigations involve a concern for caregiver and substance use. And I know that there's been some very good thinking around how to intervene, harm reduction models, how to offer interventions virtually through a web-based platform in order to access caregivers who may be struggling with substance use issue. There are a number of families where grandparents are caregivers, or where caregivers are caring for young children and their elderly parents, and the COVID-19 pandemic really exacerbates that caregiving role. It makes it very difficult to think about our instructions from our public health experts about how to isolate the elderly in multi-generational homes. Access visits, we're struggling with whether there are safe ways to facilitate the continuation of access visits. How do you deploy technology to ensure that children remain connected to families during the pandemic? particularly in situations of prolonged social isolation. How do you plan for foster parents who become infected and are no longer able to care for the children in their home? And then I think similarly, planning for youth who reside in residential settings has many considerations around infection control. If youth or staff become infected, how do you develop alternate care situations and availability of housing solutions? So the policy implications, found that there were four major themes to think about when we're responding to the need for rapid policy development. How can you increase coordination and collaboration between child protection services and their collaterals? What can we do to encourage child-specific programs? What are the particular needs of residential care settings? And then how do you strengthen child welfare systems before, during, and after pandemics? So this diagram really helped us to provide a framework to think about services who can support children served by the child welfare system. For example, Delphine has been working with schools in Quebec around specific instructions about mitigating things like the impact of a lost school year for children served by the child welfare system, as well as maintaining a vigilance for children to ensure that children who are at risk of abuse or neglect are identified if there is an emerging concern. Things like hygiene instructions, how do you interpret them for families and children in situations that may not lend themselves easily to the public health instructions. So for example, in Canada, there are communities that don't have access to safe water. So First Nations who live on reserve may not have access to clean water. What is the instruction around hand washing? We're being told to wash our hands 20 to 30 times a day. How do you interpret that instruction based on the environment? There are instructions around disinfectants and the use of chemicals. How do we ensure that those are stored safely for children? And also the availability of supplies. How do we ensure that families have those disinfectants available to them? Systems need to directly address the economic hardships caused by the pandemic. One of the things that we've become aware of is that In child welfare systems in Canada don't systematically screen for poverty. And one of the things that we've done as researchers at the University of Toronto is committed to making sure that we keep track of the emerging economic supports that are available to governments. And we're consolidating them in a concise list and ensuring that there's circulation to frontline workers in a collated document so that they can make sure that they're linking families and children with concrete resources. Access to the health communities. Again, one of the solutions that we're working on is to develop a checklist for workers to review safe health practices with families that address the latest thinking around public health instructions. And that is a tool that is very concrete and that workers can quickly link families and children to as a resource. One of the things that our ministry has done, I think, in recognition of the strain that all of these systems are under, is to implement a moratorium on children aging out of care. So no child has to age out of care during the pandemic. Our Italian colleagues very kindly spent an hour on the phone with some folks in Ontario who were trying to think through some of the issues. And one of the things that we heard very clearly from them was the importance of maintaining routine for children and thinking very precisely around child-specific programming. They stress that children need to be have fun despite the climate environment that we that they may be experiencing, that we're all experiencing, and to think about ways to suggest routines to parents that are helpful in building in some fun, in making sure that the daily routines to the best of the caregiver's ability reflect the developmental needs of the child. One of the more innovative solutions that I heard about just yesterday was by a foundation in Canada who was ensuring that children in that community who were in social isolation and who had a birthday during that social isolation period would receive a birthday box with a package of cake mix and a candle and a wrapped gift, thinking about how much a 10-year-old looks forward to their birthday all year round and how disappointing it would be not to celebrate with their friends and family in a typical way. Are there virtual community gatherings that you can help to facilitate as a potential connection and social support for families? Residential care, so children who are in care, the child welfare system certainly present with more specific concerns. There's a high risk of infection just by the nature of their communal living. Children and youth with pre-existing health conditions in a residential setting are particular at heightened risk of infection. So to ensure that pandemic plans include plans for dealing with quarantine youth and staff, should large relocation of children become necessary, that there's alternative care arrangements and housing thought through, and that there's maybe the facilitation of a connection with medical centers that could help you to intervene in a situation where there has been infection spread in a residential setting. Before the pandemic, I think there's certainly clear communication and sharing information is vital to an effective response. Things like how will you ensure the safety of children if families are isolated and not present in their typical environments? What's the messaging to communities around your organization's response? That's some of the thinking that's been done here and that I think requires constant attention. The literature was pretty clear around establishing early and clear feedback loops, what works across those concentric circles in that socio-ecological model, how do you engage populations, workers, organizations, and government systems, and how do you ensure that vital information is being shared and that it's acted upon when it needs to be. Are there critical infrastructures that need to be in place around communication? What are telework options for the delivery of interventions? What are secured platforms where there can be therapy done with families, with children in a secure and safe way? There will be during a pandemic, certainly there will be an influx of resources to agencies that both address material needs and device needs. Think about who is managing the accountability for those goods. How will job responsibilities and roles shift during the pandemic to accommodate both a potential reduction in families and children being identified to child protection services and an increased need for material goods given the economic hardships that our families and children will likely encounter. How do you coordinate with key partners? So in those circles with the child protection organization being in the middle, what does coordination look like with those key partners? And how will you communicate with them vital information? Making sure that staff have access to critical information in a regular and timely way, and that information sharing is is done in a transparent way. And then I guess the importance after the pandemic to be good record keepers, to reflect critically about what emerged as best practices and to circulate those to the broader child welfare community. The trajectory of the COVID-19 virus is not clear, and a resurgence may mean a return to some of those practices and policies that were developed, with the intention, of course, is that the child welfare system will be stronger and more effective post-pandemic. Just to conclude, our trauma-informed colleagues, think, have four very important words that we are trying to keep in mind when we think about the child welfare system's response to the pandemic. And those are information, respect, connection, and hope. The need to give clear information to children and families, to workers, to organizations, and to governments is very clear. That will help to mitigate some of the stress that people are feeling. Respect for families, for children, for the difficult work that systems are asked to do in the context where resources are inaccessible and people have to innovate in order to make sure that children are safe and well and their families have the supports they need to parent. Connection. How do you facilitate connection for children, for families, for organizations, ensuring that people feel included, that they matter, and that they can ask for help, and that someone will be able to respond to that need the best way that they can in the face of the COVID-19 environment. And finally, to leave hope to that we will get through the pandemic and that we will be changed, most certainly, but that these measures all contain the inclusion of hope that we will get through. Children, just to conclude, certainly are a heightened risk of harm, not only during the COVID pandemic, but in many cases, the social isolation, physical distancing policies that governments implement to contain the pandemic may produce some of these conditions. That we're operating with a significant limitation in our capacity to operate and provide the services to populations, and that there may be increased demand for those despite the limit in capacity. That early feedback from key stakeholders, children, youth, parents, foster and adoptive parents, caseworkers, probation officers, judges, suggest system resources and capacity are under considerable pressure, but those feedback loops are going to ensure that the responsiveness, that the interventions, the innovations really reflect those needs, and that we are very attenuated to the making sure that those needs are reflected in our systems and our policy mechanisms, and that they result in building strengths and positive coping mechanisms for communities, for families, for children. And I will just point out in the slide presentation that's going to be made available by ISPCAN that Dr. Stavaris has included some of the more important acronyms, that she's also included websites that she drew heavily on during her 5 days of the literature scan process. And she's included links to each of the resources that were most cited, and that wherever a slide referenced a document that was presented today, that there is an end note, so you can also follow the link and you'll be directed to the original source. And I would just like to conclude by thanking ISPCAN and Heather for organizing the webinar, and just to recognize that the people listening will have infinite resources and ideas about how to be responsive to children and families, and thank you for your time and attention.
Thank you so much, Barbara, for sharing this very timely information with us today. Barbara, do you mind if we leave your screen up during the question section?
No, that's great, Heather. Thank you.
Okay, that'll make this easier. And just a reminder to the audience, if you do have a question or comment, please type it in the questions box. And I will be turning it over in just a moment to Delphine to begin the question and answer session. Delphine, are you ready?
Yes, I am. So do you hear me well?
Yes, we do. Thank you.
Okay, wonderful. So there are a few questions that I think can be grouped in different sub questions, and I hope that I will be able to address all of your questions. And I will come back in a moment with these subsections that will probably be around kind of concrete strategies to help children and families thrive despite the crisis that we're facing, some clinical ideas on how to help children more specifically, and some of the lessons we can think about for caregivers. But before we do that, there was a specific question that I think really ties in very well with what Barbara was presenting. And so maybe the first question is going to be to Barb. There's a participant asking what statistical data is emerging in child abuse and neglect since the pandemic. And so maybe you can address that question more specifically.
Yes, I mean, I guess the specific answer is I don't know. One of the things that we've done at the University of Toronto, because we've just completed an incident study, is to do a quick fact sheet about the nature of referrals coming from schools to the Ontario Child Welfare System, what the primary reason for referral, what the system did with response to connecting the family to a referral, to substantiation, and what were the presenting concerns for the caregiver and for the child. That's 33% of investigations are referred by a school to Ontario Child Welfare Authorities, and anecdotally, agencies are reporting that there's a reduction in intakes or referrals for concerns for children. But I think that is something, the rate of investigation is something that organizations have to be particularly attenuated to, and to quickly understand where children are in need and are not being identified to someone that could help that child and that family. The Lit Review is also contains our children and care numbers in Canada. So thinking about children in alternative care situations and trying to get a sense of proportions, because those children will have unique needs around access to biological families, children who live in residential care settings. So I think that's an ongoing issue and ongoing systems issue that we will need to pay very careful attention to.
Thank you very much, Barb. And related to this, there's just a question that has just been posted about whether there's an increase in reporting of child maltreatment cases. And I just wanted to add to answer this question, saying that at least in Quebec, and I'm not sure it's consistent across different jurisdictions, but in Quebec, we have a decrease in the number of cases. And it's pretty a very sharp decrease of about 25 to 40% of cases across different agencies. And there are probably many reasons to explain that, but one of the most important driving force is certainly that teachers and other school personnel cannot act as safeguarding people being vigilant and reporting, especially cases of potential physical abuse incidents. So just to answer that question in particular. So looking at all your questions, there's a need for concrete examples, concrete strategies. And so I hope that I can offer some insights in that regard. So the first thing that I wanted to address is the fact that we can think about very concrete strategies and to be reminded that we, not everyone will be impacted the same way by this crisis, and which it's obvious, but in child protection, we very often say that we need to avoid using a one-size-fits-all approach. And I think it's the right time to think about how we're going to actualize that principle. There are many people that are coming to child protection with already a very full baggage of adverse childhood experiences and other traumatic experiences. If we think of different layers of oppression and marginalization as well, there are some groups of individuals who have faced a lot of adversity in their lives even before this crisis was starting. So they might require to have a lot of intense services in order to show some resilience in the face of the COVID-19 crisis. Whereas other populations might really need just some low, just one-time kind of service in order to thrive and in order to be able to bounce back from the crisis that we're facing. So when thinking about the resources that we need to put in place in child protection, I think it's very, very crucial that we continue to develop very solid screening tools, as Barb was mentioning, so that we can make sure that the right services go to the right people. In some of your questions, you were talking about street children, for instance, and I can't imagine how enormous their needs are to be protected from harm in the context of COVID-19. So for these children, we need to ensure that all the resources will be put in place and that coordination and collaboration with community organizations will be really strong, so we reach out to this very vulnerable population that might not even be able to meet their basic needs. It's this very similar with children who are now not accessing schools and who may have very important learning disabilities and who may be struggling in their educational path. For them, it's going to have enormous impact not to be able to have this access to this safety net that is the school system for them. So can we plan ahead and make sure that we don't bring them back in schools in a few months from now, hopefully, without having a plan on how we're going to support them so they can succeed? The comparison I make with schools is that many children have the summer break and they're used to not studying for 2 months or 3 months in a row. And when they come back, for some of them, it will take only 1 or 2 weeks and they get back into their routines. But for others, this is really difficult. For some of the children that are now not accessing schools, can we make sure that they have even more resources than they had before? And not to think that it's like a pause and that they're going to be back on track exactly as if nothing had happened. So I think this is something to consider. When thinking about children and how we can work with them, I think it's great to be reminded of the wide range of reactions that children can present with in the face of adversity. And they're facing a danger and a stressful event that is unpredictable, that is, you know, very large in scope. They may not have all the information, or maybe it's the opposite. They're bombarded with information that they see on TV. So they can really present with a range of reactions that go from, you know, denial and dissociation and minimizing and acting in ways as if nothing is happening. And the opposite is also true with children presenting with a lot of paranoid or obsessive compulsive, you know, behaviors as a reaction of the fear that they're just feeling. So thinking about that range of reaction is a very first step, knowing that we need to be accepting of, you know, this wide range of reactions that we may observe in children. And then I was really tempted to use some of Bruce Perry's work, highlighting the different routes for affect regulation. And I think that really for me, it resonates on how we can help children. So what Bruce is highlighting is that we have all these great top-down approaches, thinking, using our cognitive skills to be able to reflect and think about the situation as I'll be okay, it won't last forever. But for many children, this is not sufficient. If they're extremely stressed, it's not going to be that useful or not sufficient. And so he's suggesting that we use the two other routes as well as potential toolkits to use with children and youth. The second one is like more bottom-up approaches. So how can we calm down our nervous system that is extremely triggered by the COVID-19 crisis? So how can we make sure that we have ways to calm down, go for a walk and meditation and yoga, arts and craft, and all these different activities that we can do at different moments in a day? And so children, they need to have these strategies that are being offered to them. And the very third route is about social connection and how to maintain. And so there was a question about how to use technology, and that's probably as a regulation mechanism to maintain intentionally very close bonds with the people that are very meaningful and significant relationships in children and youth's lives. So I think that those are great messages that can be applied in so many different contexts. And the last category was about lessons for caregivers. And again, just to be reminded that we are the pillars and we are the adults taking care of the children. And we need to be regulated if we want to help children regulate and process and be able to go through this very difficult time. So can we support parents, foster parents, but also staff in group homes and residential care facilities so that they have capacities to be the strong pillars on which these children can rely on and find some peace and comfort in being in relationship with them. So is there a place, for instance, just to give some examples, I'm working with a lot of staff in residential care facilities, and they have this 5-minute mindfulness moment every when they start in the morning. So as a group, they come together and try to be grounded as much as possible. But they also have really fun things that they thought about, like having a bingo game, and they have that game that they decided to organize so that they come together every day to see what numbers have been selected for the day. And at the end of this big crisis, there will be a winner. So things that are also not just to bring people together, a sense of hope, a sense of joy, even if it's a difficult time. And this is extremely crucial. And maybe the very last question that is related to what I've said, but maybe I didn't address it directly, was a question about the contact with between children and their parents during, so for those who are placed. Mm-hmm. And that's a difficult one. And I would say that there are different elements that need to be considered here. So the first one, of course, is the safety in terms of the capacity to bring the parent in a place where COVID-19 is going to be contained as a sanitary problem. But I would like to draw the attention to the fact that we also need to think about the psychological safety of these children. Some parents might be quite overwhelmed now because of the crisis, and maybe the visits with the biological parents were very positive for the child who was placed before the crisis, but we need to have an opportunity to revisit that if the child is no longer benefiting from these visits because the biological parents are just overwhelmed and unable to be focused on the needs of their children. So it's not only about physical and health safety. Mm-hmm. I think it has to be broadened to consider also the emotional safety. And so who's benefiting from these visits? And I think that if we have that question, if we raise that question and we're not sure that it's benefiting the child, then we should have a leverage to say that this child probably needs a pause, a break from seeing the parents during the COVID-19 crisis. Is there anything, Barb, that I may not have mentioned or you think that I could expand on?
No.
I see that time is flying.
It's flying by. No, thank you, Delphine. I think those are very important observations and insights. I don't know, Delphine, if you want to talk a little bit about our checklist project that we're developing with our colleagues in Quebec and Ontario.
Yes, absolutely. I think this is such a promising avenue to help exactly achieve the goal of deciding where to invest the resources best. So really with your team in Ontario and hopefully to be also implemented in Quebec, this screening tool would really aim to help child protection workers identify the areas of concern for these families, children and youth, and then to offer some very concrete solutions, linking them with resources and making sure we can address the situation very quickly. So I think it's a very timely resource that will be available very soon, we hope, here in Canada.
Yes, and we're happy to connect to people that may want to adapt the methodology to the environment that they're working in. So.
Thank you, Barbara and Delphine. Just one more question that I saw several questions about. Do you have any recommendations for resources for telehealth opportunities or guidelines that you could share with the audience?
Telehealth?
Yeah, conducting visits virtually, et cetera. It seems like a few people have questions about what to do now that face-to-face visits are limited.
Well, Delphine, maybe you should go first and then I'll tell you what I think that the approach is in Ontario.
Again, I think it's all about, you know, making very good assessment. And I can so appreciate how difficult it is in that turbulent time. I think that the screening tool that we were just presenting would exactly serve that purpose, which is to first do an initial contact, maybe by phone, and then to triage and see what families are really struggling or that it's not clear and we're worrying about the safety of the children that are in that home. And then maybe to have a few of these families where we do really in-person visits, but it would help to have a screening process so that resources can be devoted to these families where we have more of a difficulty. I think that phone interventions will be needed for many of these families, and maybe with scarce resources, we can just screen better to then offer more to these children, youth, and families that are really struggling.
And I think, one of the clear messaging is that the face-to-face contact should not only be considered for urgent situations, that there should be an identification of families with underlying conditions and a vigilance that some of those conditions may need to have face-to-face contact either through the child protection system and the worker or through a collateral community support, so that it is not only reserved for children who suffer an injury, that it's used to support families and to make sure that in situations where it's possible, that face-to-face contact happens.
Okay, great. Thank you so much. We are almost at time, believe it or not. But I would like to take a moment to thank everyone in the audience for your excellent questions today. And again, to Barbara and Delphine for being with us. Unfortunately, we couldn't get to all of your great questions with so many people on the webinar. But I would like to encourage everyone to please come to the ISPCAN website, www.ispcan.org. And on our COVID-19 resources page, there are resources for professionals as well as parents and children, but there also is a forum that is open to anyone to post questions, comments, resources if you have them to share, strategies, or you can use it to discuss cases or opportunities to collaborate. You can also sign up for alerts for when others post to be alerted to that. So I really encourage you to continue this great conversation online at ispcan.org. We also encourage just one more slide. We also encourage all of you to become a member of ISPCAN if you're not already, so that we can continue having webinars like these in the future. And again, we do have some other upcoming COVID-19 webinars. Please check our website for information on those. And if you are interested in presenting or have ideas for topics for our webinar series, please contact us at resources@ispcan.org. And I just want to say thank you again to everyone, and we hope that you have a great day or night, depending on where you are. Barbara or Delphine, would you like to say goodbye?
Yes, absolutely. Just goodbye and wishing everyone to keep safe and healthy.
And yes, thank you to Heather and to Delphine, and thank you to everyone, and agree, safe and healthy.
Great. Thank you, everyone. Goodbye, and best to everyone.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.